dear friends, we are back again from Israel, called as the Holy Land. Well, it's not only just the Holy Land, but it's a land which brings hope to the world. And that's what we have been hearing from our guest, Jon Medved, who is the founder and CEO of Our Crowd, one of the leading venture capitalist firm in Israel and from Israel. Thank you, Jon, for what you shared during the earlier episode. It was such a great hope-building thought that you brought. Well, Israel is faced with many enemies trying to destroy it. But then, as you're surrounded by weapons, as you're surrounded by words of hate, which we see on the television, you're talking about hope, bringing hope to the whole world. And there's a divine protection around you. Can you talk about that?
So we have a long tradition of turning curses into blessings. Mm-hmm. The world is not perfect. The world wasn't completed. It's not done. And unfortunately, there is hatred in the world. There are problems in the world. The question is not, can you avoid them? It's how do you solve them? How do you almost use the hatred in a martial arts manner against itself to turn it into love, to turn it into peace? And so back in the days of the Bible, as the children of Israel were marching, the slave army, right? We were a nation of slaves, yes, freed by God and led by Moses into the desert. The nations at that time were scared, mm-hmm, because they realized they couldn't defeat the slave army. Mm-hmm. And finally, one king named Balak, he went to go seek some help from a man who gave good curses. His name was Bilam. And Bilam was paid very well, mm-hmm, lots of money. He said, go curse the nation of Israel so I can defeat them. Mm-hmm. And he gets up there, and of course, he doesn't curse us. He says the most beautiful blessing, how goodly are their tents, a nation Israel. This is such an important blessing that this cursor says that today Jewish religious people like myself, we say it every day when we go to a synagogue, that to remind us that curses can become blessings. Mm-hmm. So here in this country, we have a curse of no water, right? It's not a very wet place. Mm-hmm. It doesn't just rain. There's no monsoon here. No great rivers like the Ganges. Except Israel has turned that lack of water into a blessing by learning how to deal with water from a technology standpoint, how to recycle it, how to drip it to our plants, how to desalinate it from the sea. Another curse we have is that our kids have to go to the army. It's terrible as a parent to watch your kids have to go and spend years of their lives, put themselves in danger. Turns out that's a blessing. Mm-hmm. They learn to lead. They learn to be mission driven. Mm-hmm. They learn to work as part of groups. They get exposed to great technology. And believe it or not, the kids who serve in our army, the boys, live 4 years longer, life expectancy, than those who don't. So it's a gift from God. Mm-hmm. Another curse is that we have no market here. We live in a country which is very small, 9 million people. It's not like India with a billion plus or China. But we've turned that into a blessing because our companies, when they start, they go elsewhere around the world to work hard to become a global leader, not just a leader in Tel Aviv. And that's a blessing. And finally, we don't have a lot of natural resources here. We're a small little speck. That focuses us on human resources. Because when you don't have oil or gas, what you have to do is work on Nobel Prizes, work on college graduates, work on making the human resource really shine. So that's what we do. We turn curses into blessings. And I think there's a lot to be learned there by other people, that even if you have adversity, even if things are tough for you, you can make it better. Even if there's hatred, you can turn it into maybe not love right away, but respect. So our neighbors today, they respect us a lot more than they once did. Many of them are doing business with us. Many of them are working with us on a political level. And I feel that over time, these solutions will take place.
And your startups mostly are to give hope to the people.
Absolutely. Well, so the idea of starting a company is a very scary thing. Mm-hmm. I think many young people, when they finish college, if they go to IIT or to MIT or to Stanford, Hong Kong University, great universities around the world, they say, I want to get a good job. I want to work for a big company. I want to work for Apple or Alibaba or Wipro, or I want to work for a big company and I want to provide for my family and I want security. Mm. And that's fine, by the way. That's a very reasonable, respectable career. And you should get a lot of experience from that. But every now and then, a great idea will come to you. Mm-hmm. A moment of inspiration. When you realize, you know what? I can do something here which will solve this problem, mm-hmm. and I can start up. I can raise money from investors who are willing to take that risk. I can personally take the risk. And in doing so, I can not only create great wealth for myself, but I can create a company, employ people, change the world. And more young people want to do this today. Mm-hmm. It requires a lot of courage. It requires a lot of hope. But they must remember that there really is no downside. What's the worst thing that happens? It fails, okay? Failure is not a four-letter word. Mm-hmm. It's okay to fail because you learn from your mistakes, you get up and do it again, and it turns out that if you are a failed entrepreneur, you make a better investment candidate your second time around than even the first time around. So it's all good because, and that's very much part of our natural culture here, which is that we realize that failure is part of the game. You learn from your failure, and you do it again.
Do the investors still support those who have failed?
Absolutely. Smart investors know that statistically, if you have two people, and they're both pitching you the same kind of deal, they're the same quality entrepreneur, but one has tried and failed, and one is doing it for the first time, who makes the best investment? The one who's tried and failed. Mm-hmm. Statistically, that's the better investment. Because people learn from failure, the smart ones. And it's quite okay to fail, but you've got to try. If you don't try, if you don't have that courage, look, life is short. We believe in, eternal life and what, but on this planet, right now, this body, life is very short. It's crazy short. I don't believe that I'm a father of four and a grandfather of eight. I don't know where the time went. But you've got to use your time wisely. Mm-hmm. And that means taking some risk. It means going out there and trying to write a great play or to make a great movie or to invent new science or to build a great company or to create an organization or a ministry or build a synagogue or a mosque or a church. All of this is wonderful, mm-hmm. okay? But build you must. Because if you sit back and just wait, mm-hmm. nothing's going to happen.
When somebody finds a need, they have to fill it up and then do a startup.
and the way to do a startup is to make souls, okay? Is to talk to friends and to build a team. It's always about who you can get to follow you. Mm-hmm. And it's very much almost like a ministry to a certain degree. When you start a company, you have to be an evangelist. Mm-hmm. You have to go out there and explain to people what your vision is, how you're going to change the world, and you have to follow me. And many of the skills, for example, that our young people learn in the army as commanders are very, very useful because in the Israeli army, our commanders don't lead from behind. Mm-hmm. They lead from the front. They say, acharai, which means after me. I'm going to show you, I'm going to lead, I'm going to put my body in the position of greatest risk, and you're going to feel protected by me because I'm in front. That's why, unfortunately, a lot of our officers fall, because they are leading the way. But that's okay. That's how the whole people moves ahead. We have a phrase that, a klavim nofchim v'ashayra overet, which means the dogs bark, but the caravan goes on.
Thank you so much,
that's
Jon.
The way we work.
It's wonderful. Thank you for sharing your wisdom.
Thank you.